Good afternoon to all of you. On behalf of AC Media, I'm honored to introduce Professor Shanghamitra Bandyopadhyay, who's an eminent scientist and known for her work in computational biology. She is an alumni of my department, Department of Computer Science and Engineering, University of Calcutta. She did her master's from Kharagpur IIT, I think. Yeah, she received President's Gold Medal for that and completed her PhD from ISI. She has received the Bhatnagar Award in 2010, besides countless other awards like Infosys Laureate of 2017. Her areas of research interest include computational biology, pattern matching, data mining, and a lot many things. She has a lot of international collaborations, more than 300 research publications, and I won't take more of your time. So here is Professor Bandyopadhyay for you. Thank you.
Good afternoon. First of all, my thanks to the organizers here, particularly Professor Ranade for having invited me to this ACM annual event. It's a pleasure to be in particular addressing the young graduate students here. As was mentioned by my previous speaker, not many many students, undergrad students, are going into research these days, something which I think we need to look at and rectify. So we should be all into it, in it together. Rituparna mentioned that I work in computational biology. Indeed, I do work in computational biology these days. But I also work a lot in clustering, and in particular, evolutionary computing methods in clustering. And I thought this audience today would be primarily from the computer science background, therefore going into a lot of biology and the results that we have over there may not be that much of an interest here. So I decided in consultation with Professor Ranade here that maybe this is a better topic for today, multi-objective clustering and applications. So, yeah. So I come from the Indian Statistical Institute, and I'll take the first couple of minutes to introduce ISI to all of you. Many of you might know about ISI, but for the younger people there, this institute, founded in 1931 by a physicist who turned statistician by interest. I mean, he was reading some journals and came to realize the importance of this discipline for national development, human welfare, and founded this institute, which was tasked not only to study and do research in statistics, but to look at its application in many, many different domains. And therefore, in the institute, beyond statistics and mathematics, we have a very strong department of computer science. We have a strong economics department, biological sciences, physics and earth sciences. In fact, if you come to ISI Kolkata, you will see that our geology department, it has a fully mounted dinosaur fossil, and it's worth a sight. So anytime you're coming to Kolkata, please drop by in ISI and look at the dinosaur fossil. It's really wonderful to look at, and one of the very few fully mounted species fossils in India. Mohalanobis is well known for his contributions in many different areas, including in sample surveys, and also the Mohalanobis D-square statistic. He got the first computer in India to ISI in Kolkata in 1956. And the first M.Tech program in computer science started in ISI, and it still remains an interdisciplinary program, so students from many different backgrounds can come into this M.Tech program. When the country had a 1.5 year M.Tech course, ours was 2 years, and it still remains as a 2 year course. We have headquarters in Kolkata and centers all over the country. Big centers are in Delhi, Bangalore, Chennai, and Tejpur. And we have, overall, we have presence in 10 different cities. As you can see there, our flagship programs are the BSTAT, BMath, BStat happens in Kolkata, BMath happens in Bangalore. And right now, the advertisements are out. By the end of this month, the application deadline is the end of this month or early March, I guess. And the examinations held on the second Sunday of May, that is fixed. So students, especially the undergraduates, if you want to come into master's program, and the master's students here wanting to come into PhD programs, please have a look at our website, at the advertisement, and if you're interested, please do apply. So with that very basic introduction to the institute, let me go into what I will be speaking on today. How much time do I have? So it's about 12:30. I should wrap up by 1:15? Okay. So it's clustering, okay? So you've been hearing about supervised, unsupervised learning in the first talk. This comes in that category of unsupervised learning, where you do not have enough training data. Training data in the sense that you do not have data sets which are already labeled by someone. So all you have is a set of data points, and you have to do something with that data, right? So in general, if you have a set of data points, first what you would, usually what we like to do is to find groups in that data, right? Which are the data points which are similar to each other, and that essentially is clustering. So we would like to cluster the data in order to understand or get a handle about the types of the categories which appear in that data set. So clustering is a popular unsupervised classification technique where you might know how many clusters you are looking for, but you might also be unaware of how many clusters the data has. So the problem appears in many different forms and has applications in almost all domains that you can think of, and often is the first step that you take when you are doing data analytics. So without going into much of the equations here, but just one thing, suppose you want to find out k clusters, okay? Just 5, 7, 10, whatever. Suppose you know the number of clusters in the data and you want to find out the best clustering structure in the data into k number of groups. Now, very often what is done is you would like to get clusters which are compact. And one measure popularly used is like the squared error that you saw, the loss function that you saw in the first talk. It's like, okay, I will find out clusters. The best cluster structure would be that if each cluster is represented by a center, okay, so there's a cluster which is, the prototype is the center of the cluster, then the error function is how far each point is from the center. So square it, so you get the squared error summed over all the points and all the clusters. So it would, you would like to minimize that. In effect, you would want to come to clusters which are not, you know, dispersed but compact. And usually this measure would result in a cluster structure where the clusters are convex in nature, hyperspherical, in general hyperspherical, and also almost of equal sizes. Because if you just imagine, these are the problems with this particular approach, but this approach is actually widely used. But the main problem is, suppose you have a very big cluster, okay, very compact but big cluster, and a very small cluster beside it. So this particular measure, where what are you measuring? You are measuring the distance from each point to its corresponding cluster center. This will sort of force you from the larger cluster, there will be points which will be dragged into the smaller cluster. So it will not give a very good structure. But these are the problems which are there with this particular approach. And what I mentioned is popularly known as the K-means algorithm, where you are looking for K clusters, and each cluster has a mean, a centroid, a center value. Okay? So K-means clustering. If you extend it, like K-means will always tell you that each point will or will not belong to a certain cluster, okay? So this point has a membership of 1 to a particular cluster and a membership of 0 to all other clusters. So that is what you would land up with if you're doing the K-means, the hard K-means. Now, there are many points where such a 0-1 decision may not be appropriate, right? So there, you want to go towards decisions which are more fuzzy. So membership values, so each point has a particular membership to each and every cluster. So for every point in the data set that you can think of, each point would have a membership value, so it's a vector now, to every cluster, okay? And these membership, if it's very high to one cluster, then at the end you might do a thresholding and say, so wherever, whichever cluster this point has highest membership to, you assign it there. But in the intermediate, you do not lose track of that. You continue with your values, and the memberships are defined in such a way so that the summation of the membership of each point to the k different clusters would sum to one. So that is the essentially what is fuzzy clustering. And the measure that I said, the squared error, a very similar sort of measure is used for optimization. And generally, the way the optimization goes is that this is the measure that you want, would like to optimize in fuzzy clustering. So the squared error, right, and summed over all the clusters and all the points. And this measure is the membership of the kth point to the ith cluster. Membership value of the kth point to the ith cluster. So essentially, this algorithm, what it will do is it will start, or it might start with a set of initial cluster centers, just some assumption that initially I have k cluster centers. So I just pick up k points from the data. And then there is a way of computing for every point the membership values to the different clusters. Once you have the membership values, then there is another way in which you can recompute the cluster centers. So the cluster centers will keep on moving. And finally, they will ideally converge to some value, and thereafter they will not move, right? So that is where you stop the algorithm. Often you will not get such an ideal situation, and therefore you will run it for some number of iterations and then you stop. So you understand, you first, you can start with either fixing the k clusters, any randomly selected data points, or just saying that, okay, this point goes to this cluster, etc. So some initial partitioning, wherever you want to start from. And then, once you have that initial partitioning, you compute the membership value of every point to every cluster. Once you have the membership values, then you can recompute the cluster centers. And in this way, the iterations go. And finally, either you say that, okay, I've run it for 1,000 iterations, I've had enough, or you look at the error function. If it is low enough, then you stop. Or if it stops moving or moves very, very with my small values, then you can stop. So that is how the fuzzy k-means will proceed. Now the problem with fuzzy k-means, of course, is this is also a gradient descent search. And as has been mentioned, it is proved to be to get stuck at the local optima. So that is there are proofs which will show that it will certainly get stuck at a local optima. And therefore, the point is, can you do better? And one optimization technique, which I have been working with for quite some time, which many of you might be aware of, is in the broad paradigm of evolutionary computing. And we've been working with different techniques in that area. This particular thing, we've been working with something called genetic algorithms, okay? So genetic algorithm is a such method where you do not work directly with the parameters. You have an encoding of the parameters in structures where the names are borrowed from natural genetic systems, from natural evolution. So these structures which encode the parameters, they are called chromosomes. You have operators which will take you from one set of chromosomes to another set of chromosomes. So these operators, typically in genetic algorithms, they are called selection, crossover, and mutation. You can see the names, I mean, very similar to what we get to hear in natural genetic systems. So that is how genetic algorithms, they work iteratively and come up with near optimal solutions. You cannot guarantee optimality because you are going to stop after a finite number of iterations. Mathematically, there is a proof that if you run it for infinitely long, you will, with probability one, go to a population which has the optimal solution. But of course, you cannot run it for infinitely long, and therefore, what you will get. You cannot guarantee optimality, but you will get a near optimal solution. And this is a very general sort of search and optimization technique, which works pretty well for a wide variety of problems. So what we were at that point initially doing is we have the fuzzy c-means objective function, right? That fuzzy c-means tries to optimize it using a gradient descent search. That same function we would like to optimize using genetic algorithms. So that is what we were looking at. But then what we thought is often the clusters would have, I mean, the data would have clusters of different shapes, different sizes, different properties. So why look at only one objective function? Can we not only define, but can we also look at some other objective functions and do a multi-objective optimization, right? So what is multi-objective optimization? I mean, we are always doing that in real life. Even when we are trying to figure out how to go from point X to point Y, we would like to optimize the time and the cost, right? And you can imagine that if you want to reduce the time of travel, the cost of travel will go up. If you want to reduce the cost of travel, the time of travel will go up. So this is a problem, a multi-objective problem, where it is not possible to optimize both the objectives simultaneously. There's no solution which actually optimizes both. And what do you do in such situations? Typically people, I mean, it's not something new. People have been handling multi-objective optimization problems since ages. Typical approach is to take a weighted summation. Okay? Now, so I'll not go into the details of genetic algorithms here, but what I would like to show you is in this multi-objective optimization domain, let's assume that these are the two objectives that you want to maximize. So what is it that we are looking for? In single objective optimization, it is very clear. We are looking at an individual solution. We want to improve it as far as possible. In multi-objective optimization, what are we trying to improve? So assume that at any point of time, we have seen two solutions. Okay, let's say 1 and 5. Forget about this surface. We have seen two solutions, 1 and 5. So you can see very easily see that it is very difficult to compare 1 with 5, right? 1 is better on F2, but worse on F1. 5 is better on F1, but worse on F2. So what do? Essentially, you cannot do anything, at least algorithmically here, they cannot be compared, and therefore what you are looking at is this surface, okay? But at some point of time, let's say you've already also generated 2, 3, and 4. Okay, your algorithm has generated 2, 3, and 4. Immediately you can see that 5 is no longer required, right? Because 2 is better than 5 on both the objectives, 3 is better than 5 on both the objectives, even 4 is better than 5 on both the objectives. Both these objectives are maximization. So therefore you can remove 5, and if you compare 1 with 2 or 2 with 3 or 1 with 4, whatever, you can again see that they cannot be compared, okay? So essentially what happens is earlier, before I had seen these three solutions, earlier the surface that I was looking at comprised this 1 and 5. So this was the surface. Now the surface has changed and it becomes something like this. So essentially in multi-objective optimization, what we are trying to improve is this trade-off surface, which if this is the globally best surface, if it happens to be the globally, so exhaustively if you've looked at all the solutions and then you see that these are the once, and there's no other solution which is better than any of these, then this is the global best surface, best trade-off surface, and it's called the Pareto optimal front, okay? Otherwise, when you are terminating your algorithm, you will get not the Pareto optimal front, but you will get a surface which is called the non-dominated surface, of course. It's non-domination because nobody is going to dominate, no other solution will dominate any solution on this surface, but you cannot guarantee optimality. So there have been several algorithms which deal with multi-objective optimization problems without actually combining the objectives into one. Typically what was done is that if you have three objectives, O1, O2, O3, or F1, F2, F3, then you would join them with doing a weighted average. You will have W1 F1 plus W2 F2 plus W3 F3, and you will come up with a single objectives, and you use whichever is your favorite optimization technique, right? The problems are, of course, you do not know the values of W1, W2, and W3. Normalization, I mean, these might be in very different spaces, these objectives, etc. So there are different problems with this weighted average. These techniques, the Pareto-based approaches, these techniques actually keep all the objectives separate. They do not combine them, but have their own mechanism of optimizing them simultaneously. And as you can imagine, any multi-objective optimization problem does not admit a single solution. There is no single solution which is the best, right? So it will always give you a set of solutions. So because genetic algorithms or related methods, they are actually population-based search methods. Therefore, they have a natural correspondence for solving multi-objective optimization problems. So what we were doing is we were using one algorithm, which is called non-dominated sorting genetic algorithm, developed by a person who was in IIT Kanpur for many years. Now he's back. He went to US. Kollanmoy Dev. So this algorithm is widely used in the domain of multi-objective optimization, in the domain of multi-objective evolutionary optimization algorithms. So we will not go into the what essentially it does is, so it starts with a population of solutions, okay? And remember, these solutions are not directly the parameter values, but an encoding of the parameters. So it does a population, it has a population, then it ranks the population. And I'll show you through some graphs how this ranking is done. It ranks the population into several ranks, then it does some operations and comes up with a child population. So the parent population is combined with the child population. And then, so if this size is some x, this size will be 2x. And then this non-dominated ranking is again applied here. So you have ranks again. You allow rank 1 into the next population, rank 2, and so on, till the size x, you've exceeded the size x. Suppose for rank 3, if you want to take all the rank 3 solutions, then it will exceed x, the size of the population. So what do? You take only those solutions from this last rank, which are spread out in this in the search space. So you, I mean, suppose you are looking at 100 different solutions, you want to pick up a few, you look at those solutions which are not clustered together, they are spread out over the search space in order to enforce some amount of diversity in the solution space. So that is how this goes, and then this keeps on looping here. So, So this is to just show you how this non-dominated ranking happens. So suppose you have these solutions in your search space. Okay, you are now dealing with a population of points. These are your solutions, and just note that we are trying to minimize both these functions. So first, to get the rank one solutions, what is done is you look at every solution and this is the brute force algorithm. You look at every solution in this space and find out if there is any other solution which dominates it, okay? So you, for example, here, if you are looking at this, you will find that this solution dominates this because this is on F1, this is less. On F2 also, this is less than this, okay? So you will not, as soon as you find that it is dominated by any point, you forget about it. But for these solutions, you will find that there's no solution in the population which dominates any of these points, right? So these become your rank one solutions. So if you look at this, there's no one here which is better than this. There's no one here which is better than this solution, right? So these become your rank one solutions. Now, how to get rank two? You will remove these solutions from your population and then run the algorithm again. So if you remove these, then this becomes your next ranking solutions because these will no longer be dominated by any. Earlier, they might have been dominated by something here. Now, these are removed, and this you continue till you have ranked all the solutions. So that is how the ranking procedure operates, okay? and for clustering. So what is it that we are looking for in clustering? when we initially started doing evolutionary computing applications and clustering, some initial works were already there. And what they were doing is, they were sort of trying to encode each data point in that chromosome that I talked of. So if there were 100 data points that you wanted to cluster, your chromosome would be of length 100. And each entry there would say which cluster this point goes to. Now, you can immediately imagine that as soon as you do that, suppose your data set has 100,000 points or a million points. So the size of the chromosome actually increases quite a bit. On the other hand, finally, we are looking for the cluster centers. So what we started with was, let's encode the cluster centers instead of the data points. So that is what we have been doing. So if we have k clusters, we are looking for k clusters, and the data set is a d-dimensional space. So that means each data point has a d-dimensional vector feature space associated with it. So what we are going to encode are the cluster centers. Okay, and then we came up with some measures that we want to optimize. I will not go into the details of these measures, but these were some well-known cluster validity indices. Now, originally, what cluster validity indices were used for was that suppose you have a data set, you have clustered that data set using 10 different methods. Now, which solution to pick? That was where cluster validity indices were used. So what we did was that we used those cluster validity indices for optimization. And so let's not go into the details of these cluster validity indices also, but after having done that, what do we get? So we have an encoding structure now defined. We have our operators. We have an algorithm which does the multi-objective optimization, and we know what are the objectives we want to optimize. So we are now running the algorithm. And at the end, as I said, any multi-objective optimization algorithm will give a set of solutions. It will not give a single solution. And each solution is a clustering of the data, right? So at the end, assume that we have 8 solutions. But the user, if we can, we have to help the user by telling the user that this is one solution which is good. Please try with that. So what we did, imagine that we are at the end of the algorithm, we have 8 solutions, and we are clustering the data. Let's say we have 11 data points, and we are clustering into 4 clusters. So this solution, let's say, gives me this partitioning. The first 3 points going into cluster 1, next 2 to cluster 2, next 3 to next 4 to cluster 3, and the last 2 into cluster 4. So similarly, each solution actually gives me some such partitioning into 4 clusters. So what we did in order to combine these solutions, we went for a majority voting rule. So we took the 50% voting, meaning we will look at the first point and see how many solutions say that it should go to cluster 1. So here, for example, each of those 8 solutions, they tell us that point 1 should go to cluster 1. Therefore, we assign it a label 1. Here also, majority of the solutions tell me that the second point should go to cluster 1. Okay, let's put it into cluster 1. Here, here, and here, you don't have a 50% consensus, okay? There's no 50% majority there. Therefore, what we did was we put question marks there, right? And here there was this 50% agreement, so we accordingly labeled. Now you see we have a set of labeled data points which were labeled by the cluster numbers, and these question marks become the test data points. So essentially, using these labeled data points, we train a classifier. Okay, we train a classifier. Of course, we do many things there. And what we've been working with was the support vector machine classifier. You can use any other. We did many other classifiers. And once the classifier is trained and we have validated through some validation methods also, then we take that classifier and use it to predict the labels of these points. So that is how we cluster the entire data set. Okay, and that is the solution that we give to the user. Of course, there are many issues which are which have to be taken care of here. But overall, this is how we apply multi-objective optimization in clustering and then suggest one single clustering solution to the user. We've been actually applying this method, of course, on simulated data, got some good results with that. And then we went on to apply it to some real-life domains. I'll give you two real applications of this method. One is in biology, and one is in satellite images. So how to cluster the data? What data are we looking at in biology? So before going into the application, let me just say that if you look at a cell here, right, it's an eukaryotic cell, meaning that it has a well-defined nucleus. Inside the nucleus, you have the genetic material, the DNA, and this genome, you might have heard about the term genome, that's this entire stretch of DNA which has all the genes that an organism carries. So the entire set of genes, in humans, the number of genes typically between 25,000 to 30,000. So the set of all genes, right? Now, what do the genes do? The genes here actually make something called an RNA molecule, okay? A gene would be a template for the creation of an RNA molecule, and it is called mRNA, messenger RNA, meaning that it is carrying the message for making the corresponding protein, okay? And these proteins are actually made inside the cells. It's not the proteins that we are, eat this food that is very high in proteins. It's not that protein. These are proteins which are made inside the cells. And proteins, they play their roles everywhere. Okay, any biological activity that you can think of, there will be proteins which are critically important there. You think of insulin, that's a protein. Any enzymes that you can think of, they are proteins. The hemoglobin, that's a protein. Melanin, that's a protein that gives you the color of the skin. So proteins are everywhere and doing their roles, functions in every activity that goes on inside the cell. So what happens is, this gene produces something called the messenger RNA. This messenger RNA then migrates out of the nucleus into the cytoplasm and this process from the gene to the mRNA, this process is called transcription. And then the mRNA comes out and there is another activity which happens. It's called translation. Through this translation, the messenger RNA creates. It doesn't get converted to protein, it helps in the creation of the protein. So essentially, the coding genes would finally help in making the proteins. Now, from one gene, many mRNAs may be made. Okay, so this is called expression of the gene. How many mRNAs are being made by a gene? And this expression value, it changes over time, over different conditions. Right? So a gene, it expresses to certain level, meaning certain amount of mRNA is being made inside the cell. In the morning, the amount is something. In the afternoon, the amount will be something else. In the evening, it will be something else. You take a medicine, the expression will change. So it changes over time, not only over time, but if a person who does not have a particular disease and another person who has a disease, if you take the expression, there will be certain genes whose expression values are remarkably different, okay? So because of conditions, and at different time points, the expression value of the genes change. Over age, whatever genes were expressing themselves at birth, some genes will get silenced over a period of time, some new genes will become active, and so on and so forth. So there is technology available which can measure the amount of mRNA. Okay, it is possible to measure how much of mRNA is produced from each gene. So now, once you've understood this, so suppose you have 1,000 different genes and you have their expression values over time. So now, once you've understood how this data came, you can forget about the domain, you can forget about the biology behind it. It's now to you, any time series data, a stock exchange, the stock prices go up and down over time, and you do certain analytics with stock exchange data, you can use similar algorithms for doing that. So what we were doing is, we had the genes on the rows and their expression values over time on the columns. So these become expression data and essentially time series data, and we were trying to cluster this data, trying to figure out which are the genes which have similar expression patterns over time. Their variation is similar. This gives important biological information which is used for further analysis. So clustering of gene expression data is where we started from, and we used our method, the multi-objective clustering method that I mentioned for doing this. So this gives you a typical, forget about this being conditions, assume that these are time points. So these are the genes, these are time points, and this value, for example, says that it has very high expression. At this point, this particular gene, green, you see with the negative sign, it means it has low expression compared to something. So if it is a disease sample, then it will be compared to a normal sample. The expression is either high or low. Or if it is not a disease sample, then it will be high or low compared to expression of some other genes which are called housekeeping genes, right? And these housekeeping genes, you see, just like any organization, any home, we need some housekeeping activities. Whether we are sick, whether we are doing well, whatever, a poor person, a rich person, doesn't matter. Certain housekeeping activities are required. Cooking is required, cleaning is required, etc. So there are certain genes which also perform housekeeping activities, whichever tissues these genes appear in. Okay, it may come from a heart cell or a lung cell or the skin or wherever. But there are certain genes which do some standard activities. So compared to those genes, what is the condition of these genes? It's highly expressed compared to such a housekeeping gene. This is low, expression is low. And something which is close to black is similar expression, no expression, no, neither high nor low. So this is the data that we were looking at. If you look at it as a time series, you can plot it like this. And we worked with several data sets. The yeast sporulation, yeast cell cycle, meaning the yeast cell is dividing. And you take the time series, you take the expression values over different time points while the cell is dividing. So these data sets are all available. And we applied our method on that. We compared, of course, with many different methods. It's not important to go into this. But what was interesting is that when we compared the multi-objective approach with other approaches which were all single objective, the multi-objective approaches, irrespective of what model of what kernel function we were using, suppose in the support vector machine, the multi-objective approach always outperformed the single objective ones. And among the multi-objective approaches, the one with support vector machine with an RBF kernel performed the best. But that is not of, you don't have to go much into this. But the question is, how did we compare again? So we were looking at another index, which we have not used while optimizing, an index called the silhouette index, which ranges between -1 and +1. And larger values of this index indicates that the clustering is better. So we were actually comparing the clustering methods with respect to this index. This gives you, in another way, the same results. So you can see this, these are the clusters which are obtained. Reasonably good clusters have been obtained. This is called the heat map. That's a typical way biologists look at the cluster structure. So this gives you one application where we were applying it for gene expression clustering. And this, of course, is another way of looking at the goodness of the clustering by looking at the biological functioning. So we have a cluster, okay, this is a cluster of genes, but who says, okay, according to my algorithm and according to the expression data, that cluster was good. Huh? Good in terms of whatever distance I have defined. It could be the cosine distance, it could be any other thing. So biologically, what is good? The genes that go into the same cluster should typically have the similar sort of biological function, right? That is what biologically would make sense. And that is how this is computed in terms of, this is called gene ontology. So GEO, you can, you input the set of genes that you've got into the same cluster into this GEO, the gene ontology. There is a software which is available where you can do it directly. You don't have to do everything yourself. And then look at how the different methods are performing. Again, we found this multi-objective approach to not only to of course outperforming all other approaches, but the multi-objective SVM based approach where we were combining using the method that I said, vis-a-vis from the multi-objective approach, if we took the best, if we looked at individual solutions and whichever had the best silhouette index, so that best was worse than when we actually did our combination using a classification approach. So this gives you one application. The other application, which I will go quickly go through, I have just about 5 more minutes. So this is a remote sensing image analysis. Again, this is a very old data. So don't look at, I don't have that. But anyhow, this image was 512 pixels by 512 pixels. So total of 262144 pixels, okay? And the image, we were working with Kolkata and Mumbai images. And the images are present, are given to us in 4 different bands. Blue, green, red, and near infrared. Meaning, for every image, there are 4 sub-images or 4 images make up the entire data. Okay. So for the same region, in the blue band, we have the intensity readings, in the green band, in the red, and in the near infrared band. So now, you forget of that image part. Think of every pixel, 512 by 512, which makes 262144 pixels. So think of the first pixel. It has 4 intensity values, right, in the 4 bands. Second one, again 4 intensity values. So essentially now if you think of it as any other data set, what you have is 262144 rows and 4 columns. And there we would like to cluster this data, okay? What are we expecting? That the clusters, suppose there's a water body. All the pixels which make up the water body should go into a single cluster, because they would typically have very similar intensity values in all the 4 bands. Anything which is concrete should go into some other cluster. The vegetation regions should go into, so essentially we are trying to cluster the land cover types in the image by taking this clustering approach. There's a segmentation approach which you could do. But this is an alternative approach. So you can see here, then the size of the data set is 262144 and the number of bands is 4, which means it's in a, as if in a 4-dimensional space. We are trying to do the clustering. So this was the image. This is the river Hooghly, which flows by this, through the city. This part is the Calcutta part. This part is the Howrah part. More vegetation there actually, and more concrete and everything there. This is the airport which we have. This is the Salt Lake area of the city. So we were trying to do this. First we did fuzzy C means clustering, did not perform very well, had a lot of confusion between the water and the open space and the concrete, etc. Then we went for multi-objective clustering, where we did pretty well. In fact, this image has a lot of artifacts here. So we were doing this multi-objective SVM clustering. You can see it is doing quite well in this particular case. And we were also looking at this IRS data of Mumbai, where it's very difficult to explain here right now, but the point is many different land cover types which had very small regions here and there could be identified. So without going into the details of those images, because we also did a quantitative analysis, of course, where we were comparing the clusterings obtained with another index, and it showed that the SMOGA SVM, that is the one where not only multi-objective is used, but the results are combined using a supervised approach. It was outperforming the other approaches for both the images. So with those two applications, I mean, there have been other applications in many, many other domains, including in of our clustering methods, including in portfolio management, etc. So with those two applications, I'll sort of summarize that clustering is an important problem and solutions are always needed. Nowadays in biology, for example, I talked about gene expression data. So what was it? It's expression value of the different genes, but different genes coming, essentially the standard expression data is data from different cells. So when you are taking that the mRNA, you cannot or you were not able to, we were not able to identify single cells and do it, but it was an average value over, say, let's say 1,000 cells. So you scrape a portion of the skin or scrape a portion of the tissue and then you take your expression values. So it's actually an average value over many different cells because it was not possible to get single cell data. But now it has become possible to look at the expression of genes in each and every cell. So single cell data is now available. The problem or the challenges have become great because now the data set is in huge dimensional space and huge number of data sets because so many cells you can take the results from. If you think of even cancer, okay, there's this tissue, which the tumor, it's very heterogeneous. So you need to really understand at the single cell level. And there, an important task is to identify very rare cells. That has important information, which would generally be missed. But if your algorithm is able to come up with clusters, which are very small in size, or maybe some sort of, you know, something called outlier detection, maybe of more use there, because you really need to figure out which are the cells which have different type of signatures from the mass. And these rare, and they will be very rare. They'll be only maybe out of 100,000, there'll be just about 50 cells making up that set of rare cells. So how to come up with such clustering algorithms, huge dimension and huge amount of data, these are the challenges which continue, which are there, and therefore research in these areas continue to happen. So with that, I will conclude. My acknowledgements, of course, to my family and my teachers, without whom I would not be where I am today, to my institute, DST and DBT, for funding a lot of my work and my research, the Alexander von Humboldt Foundation, ICTP Italy, and the Infosys Foundation also, for quite a bit of money, and of course my students and collaborators around the world. Thank you very much.
Any question?
Questions are not silly. So when I don't find any questions, there are two things. I've been very lucid or very obtuse. But anyhow.
Yeah. I was thinking that you are talking about clustering of genes, right? So how good it will be if you have really, really very diversified combination of genes. How good your clustering
It should work better then. If the genes are really behaving differently,
yeah.
I mean, then the clustering algorithm should...
So you think multi-op...
Oh yes, multi-objective optimization, I mean, that approach will always work. Yeah. But if the behaviors of different groups of genes are truly different,
yeah.
Then, I mean, that's a much simpler case to handle. Okay. For the clustering algorithm.
So if it is not so diverse,
it's difficult because then everything will be very similar to each other. So
okay.
Their clustering would be more difficult. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, Shankh Mitra Di, if I can call you.